Well, we are picking back up in our master class on the topic of prayer, and tonight we're dealing with a very important topic, the topic of God's kingdom. Our text that we've been given dealing with the topic tonight is asking for his kingdom. It's thy kingdom come. And so that is what we're going to be looking at. We're going to be kind of, you know, thinly slicing it and looking how that applies to our life, what we can expect, and I'm hoping to give you more of a comprehensive view of what the kingdom of God is all about and what the Bible means, what Jesus is talking about when he mentions the kingdom of God. Now, let me ask a question. How many Disney fans are out there? How many Disney fans? Okay. Now, the other night, we were in downtown Riverside, my wife and I driving through, and I had to take a double take because there was this lady walking in downtown Riverside, and she had on like a whole Disney getup with mouse ears. And I was like, what in the world? You know, and I'm like, does she have mouse ears on? She has mouse ears on. That's strange. Okay, we're not at downtown Disney. Okay, we're in downtown Riverside. Why is she sporting the ears? You know, this is a dedicated fan, right? She's nowhere near the park. She's still repping the gear. And we, you know, look at those people and it's like, all right, that's your thing. Go for it. You know, you're a genuine Disney fan. Now, my wife is one of these individuals, okay? I would call them strange individuals, but she loves Disney. Now, she's got an amazing voice, incredible voice. And so every day you can walk or go around my house and you will hear a Disney princess song. Like, she sings all the time, which is awesome. I love hearing it, but it's always these Disney songs from Tangled or, you know, from Sleeping Beauty, and it's just constant. She sings so much, my little son started singing. I'm like, son, no, let mama sing the girl songs, the princess songs, you know? And she sings for the ladies at Valor. And if we could be at Disneyland every day of the week, we literally would. Okay, that's how much she loves the park. That's how much she loves being there. And it's her happy place, being at the magical kingdom. And there are some people that go all out when it comes to Disneyland. You know, they've not only got the ears, one for each occasion, but they've done like family tie-dyed shirts that match. They're pin collectors, and they've got all the mugs and the figurines. You know, you see them around, and they've got tattoos even. Like, what's up with Disney tattoos? Like, you're really hook, line, and sinker this much into Disney. You're going to tattoo your body, all right, with one of the characters. Now, even last night, I went and got my taxes done at a house, and when I was walking through the home, this was one of those people, okay? They had, like, stuff, pictures and, you know, stuff hanging, costumes everywhere in the house. More stuff in that house than in, like, the Disneyland store, all right, was in this house. And I'm like, wow, I'm sure these type of people would say, when I die, cremate me and dump my ashes in the moat around Sleeping Beauty's castle. Like, this is how dedicated, okay, these people are when it comes to the magical kingdom. They never want to be separated from it. Now, Disneyland has capitalized on this whole idea of the Magic Kingdom. They've even called it the happiest place on earth. And there's songs about it, and people get excited. Now, I think this concept has worked because Disneyland is hinting at a true, soon-to-be reality. There is a true sense that there will one day be a kingdom which is the happiest place on earth. Sorry to break it to you, it's not going to be in Anaheim, okay? It's probably going to be where King Jesus is at. You see, the kingdom of God is going to come, and it is going to take residence here on earth, and there we will gather around King Jesus, and we will say it's truly the most magical thing. It will be the happiest, most amazing place that we've ever been, that we've ever experienced. We will see our King face to face, and that'll be better than any mouse, okay, any day. There will be songs, there'll be joy, there'll be eating, it'll be amazing, okay, when King Jesus sets up his location. Now, C.S. Lewis talks about this, you know, shadow to a real thing, a substance, you know, to something that we would tangibly see and feel. He says, creatures are not born with a desire, unless that desire can be satisfied. He said, babies are hungry when they're born because there's such a thing as food. Ducks, when they're born, they want to swim because water exists. And he makes this point that the human heart longs for something more. And if this world can't satisfy what we're longing for, then obviously there's something beyond this world that we're meant for. And I think every one of us long for this heavenly kingdom, on earth as it is in heaven, where we will have our tears wiped away, no more pain, no more sorrow, where we will reign with our King. And the rights will be made, or the wrongs will be made right, and things will be put the way that they're supposed to be. The curse will be reversed. All of us long for that day, and I'm telling you, that day is coming soon. You know, you think Disneyland's magical, just wait till you see God's kingdom. It's going to be amazing. Tonight we're talking about the kingdom of God. And we are going to look at what the kingdom of God is, where to find it, how to be a part of it, when is it going to be. And again, as I mentioned, our text there in Matthew 6:10 says, "Thy kingdom come." What was Jesus in reference to when he made that claim, "Thy kingdom come"? Well, actually, before, let's pray and ask that God would touch our hearts and prepare us for this. Lord, we just pause and ask that you would ready our hearts. You are the King of the universe, Jesus, and we bow our knee to you. We subject ourselves to your rule and your authority. You will rule the world one day soon, but I pray, God, you would rule our hearts now. That, Lord, you would help us be obedient and loyal to you. And so, King, now would you speak to us and encourage us in your word. It's in Jesus' name we pray. Amen. When the Bible talks about the kingdom of God, it mentions it in a few different ways. It says the kingdom of God. Sometimes it'll just call it the kingdom, or it'll call it the kingdom of heaven. Now, of the New Testament books, Matthew mentions the kingdom of God, or the kingdom of heaven, more than any other book in the New Testament. And Matthew, being one of the synoptics, really keys in on this topic as being central to Jesus' earthly ministry. Jesus' first words, really, we see there, were, "Repent, the kingdom of God is at hand." This is something Jesus was quite familiar with and talked about a lot. A lot of his parables revolved around this idea of God's kingdom. And this was a common thing for the people of his day to hear about, that there's a kingdom coming and a kingdom they should be a part of. Now, before we get into God's kingdom, we need to understand that kingdoms belong to who? To kings, yeah, so you can't separate the two. I know that in our Valor studies, in our V2 studies, we've been thinly slicing these topics. Our Father in heaven, hallowed be your name, your kingdom come. But Jesus was saying this with one breath. He's recognizing the King of heaven and his domain. So it's the King and his kingdom together. You don't separate them, you keep them together. And when we are going to talk about the kingdom, I want you to think about it in a way regarding his rule, the king's authority, his reach, how powerful the king is. And when you understand it this way, I think you rightly understand some of the implications that come with it. So when I say the kingdom of God, you're going to think about the king and his power. You're going to think about his subjects being under his control, because really here, Jesus is the king of the universe. God is the king of the galaxies, not just planet Earth, but everything is under the power and the control of God. God made it. He controls it. He causes it to operate. Really, he's holding it all together. The universe is under God's jurisdiction. He's the highest authority in all of the galaxies. And all creation is under his feet. You see, Jesus is the king, we are the subjects. We're not the king, it's not our throne. We're just peasants, really, okay? We're the people of God underneath the king of the universe. Jesus literally is called the King of Kings and the Lord of Lords, and all mankind one day will bow their knee to this king. Everyone of all time will appear before the throne, and they will recognize him as the king of the universe. They will speak it with their mouth. Now, what again is the kingdom? When we read the kingdom again, it's his authority, it's his rule, it's his power. Now, I want you to think of it in two parts here. You've got the internal and then the external. You've got the spiritual way in which God's authority and his rule and his reign exists. And then you've got a future, what is to come, an external way that God's authority, his rule, his reign is going to be present. So internally, currently God, our King, right now, is ruling and reigning in his people spiritually. If you're a Christian and you love Jesus, then he's ruling in your heart right now in a spiritual way. You can't see him, but he sees you. Okay, I can't see his throne, but I am subject to his authority. Like, I am paying respects to the crown, right? He's holding the scepter. I am not. I can't see that, but I know it spiritually, that I am having God's kingdom rule inside of me. I have said, God, your will be done, not mine. And the kingdom of Jason has taken a back seat to the kingdom of God. I've stepped off the throne of my life, and God, it's your spot. That's where you're supposed to be. So inwardly, every Christian is allowing God, is putting God as the authority in their life. He's inwardly ruling and reigning and displaying his authority over you. And our job is to obey and live for our King. So that's one way when we hear the kingdom of God. It's inward. But also now, the Bible describes the outward or the external rule and reign display of God's authority. You see, soon Jesus, our King, is going to come. And he's going to set up shop here on earth. And he is going to externally, in a physical way, dwell with us. He is going to be our King. You will see him. You will see the throne. All eyes will understand and all knees will bow. Everyone will pay homage, okay, to his highness. We will be obedient to the crown. We will bow before him. He will rule and reign. Now, the Bible describes him coming not as a lamb, but as a lion. It says he's going to rule with a rod of iron. He's going to clean house, okay? Like, he's going to come and he's going to get things back in order. And then it's going to be the happiest place on earth. Now, the book of Revelation talks about this. Talks about heaven and earth coming together, and as I mentioned, tears being removed and pain and sorrow. And we even see glimpses of it a little bit sooner than the new heavens and new earth in the millennial reign. When the 1,000-year time as Jesus is, you know, bringing in these years of peace, we see his government. And we see his authority all throughout the world. You see, one day soon, Jesus' authority will not only be in you as his person or as his people, but it will be over you. And to say it one way, the King of the universe is now spiritually dwelling within us, but soon he's going to come and physically dwell with us. And I think it's going to be crazy cool, you know, to be there and see Jesus. You know, faith will be replaced with loving him face to face. We'll see him. We'll reign with him. And he'll be our God and we will be his people. Now, these two parts, the physical and the spiritual, the internal and the external, is something that we should understand. Now, we are currently living in an interesting time because he could appear at any moment. You know, nobody can bring in or usher in the kingdom any quicker. But he's coming soon, all right? Like, the kingdom is about to be, like, it could be tomorrow that he establishes his power and his domain. And Jesus tells us to pray for it. He says, pray, thy kingdom come right now. In the Greek, it's like this imperative, saying, right now, right here, today, come, let your kingdom, let your rule, let your authority not only rule the world, but rule my world. Take control of the place and can take control of my life. Take control of my heart. And so while we're waiting for Jesus to set up his kingdom, what we got to be is just loyal subjects, living in obedience to him, enjoying the king, living worthy of the kingdom, making sure that he is ruling our world. So let me ask you tonight, is Jesus the king of your life? Like, really? Like, is he really ruling in your life? Or are you on your own throne, so to speak? Are you trying to take control of your own life? A lot of times as believers, you know, we try to take control of our own lives and don't rightly subject it under his control. Listen, he's the king, as I've mentioned. We are not. We are just the subjects. We are just the peasants in the kingdom. We need to allow God to establish his kingdom in our hearts. Now, the New Testament has a lot to say about this, and I want to kind of take you through some scriptures to show you how this process comes about throughout the Bible. You see, the kingdom of God is impossible to get into. Okay, there are no immigrants in the kingdom of God. You can't sneak in. Okay, there's big walls, there's a gate. The vetting system is pretty crazy. You have to be born in the kingdom, okay? You have to be born again. That's what John 3:3 says about the kingdom of God. Okay, not just anybody can get in, but it says in John 3:3, Jesus answered and said to them, "Most assuredly, I say to you, unless one is born again, he cannot see the kingdom of God." So how does somebody join the kingdom of God? Well, just like being born in a nation or in a country that makes you a part of that country. I'm an American because I was born in America. So you have to be born in God's kingdom in order to be a citizen. You have to be born again. If you're not born again, you're not in the kingdom. You're not in the kingdom, you're not going to heaven. You're not going to spend eternity with him. You must be born again. This is the only way in, no other way. Now, Jesus makes this very important because the reality, not everybody's born again. People are in the dark, the kingdom of darkness, sin, the kingdom of the evil one. Everyone at birth is born banished from God. We're all in a place where we are in desperate need to be born again. And unless we are, then there is no hope. That's the only way getting inside this wonderful place. Now, Jesus gave instructions on how to be born again. As I mentioned, the first words of Jesus giving instructions to the people about how to get in the kingdom of God, Mark 1:15, he said, "The time is fulfilled and the kingdom of God is at hand. Repent, believe in the gospel." So if you want to get in the kingdom, Jesus gives instructions. He says, you got to be born again. You want to be born again? He says, you got to do two things, turn and trust. Turn from your sin and trust in the Savior. Repent, the kingdom of God is at hand. And so if you personally want to be with God for the rest of eternity, then you got to turn from your sin. And then as you're turning from sin, what is wrong? You're turning to Jesus and trusting in him and enjoying him and surrendering your life to him as, again, as king, as the rightful king. It's amazing to see this take place. I mean, I'm stoked that every week we see people come to faith at Harvest. Like every week, you can't take it for granted. When Pastor Greg is preaching the gospel on a weekly basis, like miracles are happening. I don't know if you realize that. People in the darkness are being transferred to the kingdom of light. Okay, they're lost and then they're found. Like it's crazy cool. Not too many churches around our nation are doing this, giving opportunity for people to repent and trust, to turn and trust. And I'm thankful it was done in my life. I'm thankful that someone preached the gospel of the kingdom to me, and I turned, and I trust, and I'm still turning and trusting. I'm thankful that I'm in the kingdom now because somebody shared it with me. Somebody told me about the Savior. Somebody told me about the King, and it's really changed my life. And once a person receives this prepaid ticket to get in, they get to go in and enjoy the kingdom. But tonight, what I wanted to kind of focus on for a moment is what we should be doing now that we're in the kingdom. Most of us in this room, if not all of us, are already in God's kingdom. And so I want to give you instructions of what you should be doing now that you're in. Now, you might know people that aren't in yet, so preach the gospel to them. But now for those of us that are in the kingdom, there are three things we should be doing now that we're in God's kingdom. Number one, we should be seeking. Number two, we should be showing. And three, we should be sharing. You seek, you show, and you share. Seek. I'm sure you know the verse. Matthew 6:33 says, "But seek first the kingdom of God and his righteousness, and all of these things will be added to you." as citizens of heaven, we seek his kingdom and his righteousness above everything else in our life. This is what makes us believers. You see, we're in the park. You see, we're in the kingdom. It's like we just got in, and you don't, like, putting it back in Disneyland terms, you don't pay the however much money it takes to get in that place, right? You don't pay, walk in, and then turn around and go back home, right? You walk in the park, and you go enjoy the rest of the park, okay, for the remainder of the day. When you become a believer, going in, okay, is the beginning step. You now have got God to enjoy for the rest of your life here, then for the rest of eternity. You see, the Christian life doesn't just stop at salvation. It begins there at salvation. Where you're going, okay, I'm in the kingdom. What's next? Now you seek his kingdom. You prioritize the things revolving around the king and him himself. You seek first the kingdom and his righteousness. See, what's interesting to me, you know, when you go to Disneyland, some of the first things that you do when you walk in the park, the first thing I do when I go to Disneyland, you know what I do? I walk to Starbucks, okay? That's what I do, because I need the, I call it Charbucks because they burn the beans. But anyways, I go to Charbucks, I get my coffee, okay, then I go sit down on a bench, and then I let them do their thing, right? So my wife and my son always wants to go on the Star Wars rides, and so it's the first thing he wants to do. You know, when he gets in Disneyland, he's always making a beeline, you know, for Star Tours. When we're in the kingdom, the first thing we're supposed to be seeking is the king himself. Like, this is what you should be daily pursuing, is God. Not going after his gifts or the things that he gives, but going after him himself. Daily chasing after, seeking after the Lord. Wanting to be close to him. Explore the relationship with him. Draw near to him. Enjoy his very presence. You're seeking first, prioritizing. You're scheduling God, and everything else in life will revolve around that. How often do you hang out with the Lord on a daily basis? Do you spend quiet time with him, reading and praying? Going, Lord, here I am. King, here I am. I want to spend time with you. This is what it means to be a believer. It's enjoying the very presence of God. Now, Pastor Greg has said that before you say your kingdom come, you have to say my kingdom go. Well, we have to recognize, you know what? It's not about Jason anymore. It's about Jesus. It's not about you. It's about him. It's not what I want. It's what God wants. What does the king want for my life? God, your kingdom come, my kingdom go. And I'm pursuing that. Now, it also says there in Matthew 6:33 to seek his righteousness. And I think that's really important, because there will never be a day in heaven when someone who is there will think for a moment about what they've done to get there. It will never happen that in eternity someone will think for a moment, I'm sure glad I did all of those prayers to get here. I'm sure glad I gave up all of those things to arrive at this place. No one will ever for a moment think that they've earned heaven. We will all recognize it was the good king that brought us in. It's the good king that has allowed us to come in. Colossians 1:13 says, for he has rescued us from the kingdom of darkness. He's rescued us. And he's transferred us into the kingdom of his dear son. We're seeking him, his righteousness, because I don't got any, for the rest of our lives here and for the rest of eternity there. You see, daily we're preaching the gospel to ourselves. I'm daily remembering what Jesus has done for me. I'm daily saying, God, you've been too good. King, you've been too amazing. I deserve the punishment, but you took it for me. Daily, as believers, we're seeking after our Lord. Now, secondly, what we should be doing while we're in the kingdom is that we should be showing. You seek, and then you show. As people of God, other individuals should be able to tell that we have a new citizenship. You know, when you go somewhere with your passport, when you go to a different country, generally they identify something about you. You know, when I was in New Zealand for some Harvest Crusade stuff, there was something they identified me as, an American, because of my what? My accent, that's right. Hey, mate, you got an accent. And I'm like, no, I do not have an accent. You do. You know, like, you throw some shrimp on the barbie. You know, like, I'm like mocking him. I'm like, no, your accent's giving you away there. People should be able to tell that you've changed your address, that you're from a different location. You should have an accent. You should have something that gives you away as now being a part of the people of God. You should be showing it. And that is what, well, the book of Thessalonians chapter 2, verse 12 says. It says, we exhorted each one of you and encouraged you, charged you to walk in a manner worthy of God, who calls you into his own kingdom and glory. You see, we should show that we are a part of the kingdom by our actions and by our attitude. Our actions and our attitude. Your actions should show that Jesus is your king. Walking worthy. Being a representative of God. You know, if you were the president's child, you would be held to a higher standard and not allowed or not privileged to do other things that most kids can do because you're the president's kid. I mean, really think about it for a moment. You know, if you were a rebellious teenager and you were the president's child, you probably would not make some of those foolish decisions because there's something weighing in the balance, your dad's reputation. Like, oh man, I can't do that. I can't go to that party. I can't do those things. I can't, you know, run amok because it would bring a stain upon dad's reputation. He's the president. I'm the president's child. You know, there's something that we recognize going, yeah, you probably would live a little different because you're in a fishbowl and all eyes are upon you. You, listen, you're a son or a daughter of the king. You're bearing his reputation. You've got his signet ring. All eyes are looking at you as his representative, as his ambassador. You're an ambassador of the king. And we should be showing in our actions, well, a lifestyle that's worthy of him. That people can look at us and go, oh, yep, I see that. That's Jesus stuff over there. Although, yeah, they talk like that because they love Jesus. Oh, they do that because, oh, they work hard. You know, they're on time for work. They're a good mom or a dad. Oh, they're really a nice neighbor. You know, they're giving of their time and their efforts. They look just like Jesus because Jesus is their king. This is expected because we get to show the world our God. And it's evidenced that his rule and reign is in our lives. So we're walking worthy of him in our actions, but now also in our attitude. Your attitude should show that Jesus is your king. In Hebrews chapter 12, talking about the kingdom of God, it says, since we are receiving a kingdom that is unshakable, let us be thankful and please God by worshiping him with holy fear and awe. For our God is a devouring fire. So our actions are worthy of the kingdom. Now our attitude. The Bible's saying because we're in the family, because we're in his realm, because we get to spend eternity with him, we should be thankful and worshipful. You should be daily going, God, I can't believe it. I can't believe how good you are today. New mercies this morning when I woke up. You're still loving me. You're still answering my prayers. You've never left. You're here. Oh, we should have a sense of thankfulness and also a worshipful heart. It's saying there in the text, worshiping him with holy fear and awe. And I think worship is really the fuel to all of this. That is what we will be doing for the rest of eternity. I mean, listen, family, we're going to be together worshiping the king. So your worship now fuels the right lifestyle, the right attitude. And that also fuels our third point, how we share. So we seek, we show, and then we share. But even before we share here, you know, in prepping this study, I got to thinking about the kingdom of God. And as I was just sitting there, you know, reading my Bible and writing down some thoughts about the kingdom of God, something blew my mind the more I thought about Jesus being the king of the universe. Like, back up for a moment. God is the king of the universe. Not just earth, like go bigger, okay? Pull the telescope really far back. God is really, really big. It says he holds the universe in the span of his hand. Okay, so he's big. In the beginning, when he made Adam and Eve, like they're on planet Earth, tiny, tiny, tiny. They're tiny. Okay, God big. They rebel against the king of the universe. I don't know why he just didn't, dead, gone. You know, like, I don't get it. Like, it just sitting there thinking about, like, wow, God, you were like, why didn't you just like exterminate them? Like, get rid of them. How dare they challenge the crown? How dare they come up against you and all of your authority? Like, how dare Adam and Eve do that? Are you kidding me? Like, he has made a perfect world. Trees and animals all obeying him. It's the happiest place on earth, and he is dwelling with mankind. He's there. In his greatness, yet in his intimacy, he's there, and they're with him, and they're made to live in harmony with the Creator, but they rebel against him. I just couldn't grasp it there. They challenged God. And instead of capital punishment or extermination, God simply did separation. He did banishment, which in understanding is a lot worse. They were to live in the king's land without the joy and intimacy of the king himself. The very joy of existence they were separate from. Because Adam and Eve and all humanity born since are rebels separated from the king, you know the story. There's been a big chasm. There's been a big separation. But the king did something. The king of the universe did something about our rebellion. Jesus, the king, came. And he took the punishment. The king took the punishment the people deserved. We're the rebellious ones, but the king dies. Like, this is insane. Absolutely insane. Incredible message. That the king takes the punishment the people deserve just so they could dwell with him. When you fully grasp what the king has done, you naturally want to tell others about it. You naturally want to share. You can't hold it back. Like those diehard Disney freaks, okay, that we're talking about, the ones that got tattoos, stickers on their cars, their children have tattoos, you know, like those diehard Disney people, you know, you don't have to tell them to put it on their social media. You don't have to like pay them to get the tattoos or to wear the weird stuff or to go to the park and wait in long lines for nothing. Go when it's raining and stand in the rain for like a minute ride. Okay, you don't have to pay them to do that. They pay to do it. Like they want to do these things. Why do they want to do this? Because they enjoy it. They enjoy Disneyland. They enjoy the kingdom, and that's why they share it. That's why they talk about it. You know, and it's grassroots evangelism. All these people, they're evangelists. They're Disney evangelists. They're ambassadors. And they see it as their joy to experience it, and they want others to experience it. Are you finding your joy in the King? Do you find him to be your joy? Some Christians are more excited about the new Star Wars land coming out than Jesus' kingdom being established. Listen, God should be our joy. He should be our everything. Disneyland cost you a fortune. God's kingdom cost him a fortune. You get it freely. At Disneyland, you pay. In God's land, he paid. You know, you will naturally talk about Jesus the more you enjoy him. And so for our master class on prayer, this is my point. One day, his kingdom is going to come. Until that day, let his kingdom come in you. Let him rule your heart until that day that you rule with him. Let him establish his kingdom in your heart as it is in heaven. And let's seek and show and share it. Amen? Amen. Let's pray. Father, I thank you for my fellow heavenly citizens here. God, I pray that you would give us a mindset where we're heavenly minded, thinking about that day, anticipating it, living for it, talking about it. God, I pray that you would rule and reign in our hearts and help us be obedient and subject to you. Thank you, King, for all that you have done for us. We don't deserve it, but we love you. It's in Jesus' name we pray. Amen.